Hi, welcome to the show. We're running a little bit late here due to the untimely death of one of the gnomes in Sam's laptop computer, but we're back online with another one. I'm David Beard, the host of your show tonight here at Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles, Pennsylvania's premier transportation museum. The museum is all about vehicles, both powered and unpowered, that were built here in this part of Pennsylvania, the manufacturers of those vehicles, and the people who made vehicle history in this region. So if these and other automotive topics are of interest to you, then this is the show for you. If you'd like to contact the museum at any time, the phone number is 610-367-2090, and the email is mail@boyertownmuseum.org. During the next hour, our regulars will be here. Dan Olson bringing us a little bit more information from his Well, What Do You Know? Thanks for being here, Dan.
Thanks for having me again.
Okay. Mike Inessa here for Tech Talk, a lot more fascinating car stuff. Always good to see you, Mike.
Thank you, Dave.
And our guest is Sam Fiorani. He's here to talk to us about some famous automotive lemons and the people who love them. And we appreciate you coming back on the show again.
Thank you.
And of course, our new segment, the Curator's Corner, with our curator Kendra Cook. She'll be talking about different vehicles from the museum's collections. So we're glad you all tuned in tonight. If you want to be part of the program, just pick up the phone and call anytime during the live broadcast. Try and stick with the topic of the particular segment. And you can call 610-378-0426. That's the line into the studio. So I guess without any further ado, we will move along to Well, What Do You Know? With Dan Olson.
Okay. What I'm going to talk about is back in 1965 in February, so that's 46 years ago next month, in the GM Proving Grounds in Mesa, Arizona. Chevy introduced an engine. It was the 396 cubic inch engine called the Turbojet V8. And it had three different sizes to it, and one of them was the 325 horsepower for the all-new Caprice luxury car that they started then. There was another size of 425 horsepower that was an option for Corvettes. And then the third one is the 375 horsepower that was made on a very, very limited basis for Chevelle. And that's what I'm going to be talking about, is that Chevelle. It's called the Z16 Chevelles. And actually, I think more technically it's the RPO Z16, RPO meaning regular production order. The Z is an option package, and the 16 was just a number used by Chevrolet to identify that car, which again was a 1965 Chevrolet Chevelle Malibu Super Sports Coupe. That is a mouthful. And it had this 375 horsepower V8 engine. Again, it was 396 cubic inches. And it was developed for a reason, this whole Z16 package. It wasn't just, you know, a car with an engine in, but they did it to really promote this 396 engine. I already mentioned it was in the new Caprice Chevy and also in the Corvette. Not a lot of numbers in 1965. In 1966, then they started really pumping a lot of them out to the public. The Chevelles, the Z16s, they only made reportedly 200. Some people say that it's 201. There was a convertible in there, but you know, that's a debate, and you can read the debates on the internet and stuff. It's kind of interesting discussion, but nobody can prove it one way or the other. The Z16 wasn't just that engine, but the engine was the biggest part of it. And you could show the first picture, please. And it is a picture of one of those Z16s. And there it is. And kind of nice looking car, I think, and yellow. And it's a, I believe I called it a sports coupe, which was Chevy's terminology for a two-door hardtop, which that is. Okay, you can show the next picture. This would be the 396 engine in it, and that was the L37 version. And again, 375 horsepower at 5,800 RPM. It was a nickname for this. It was called the porcupine head, and the reason for that is the valves were not all lined up straight. They were all angled. And so if you took the valve cover off and you look at all the valve stems sticking up, they were all different angles. And the reason for that is so they would open up into a combustion chamber that was best suited for that with airflow and stuff. And it was called a semi-hemi head also. Not a Chrysler Hemi, but you know, this is a Chevy and it was sort of a Hemi head. Combustion chamber. This is also called the a rat engine, and that was the first time I've seen that term. I mean, I've seen that term for a long time, but I think it originated with this engine here, the rat engine, which was the big block Chevy engine from 65 there. A lot of things made it a very high performance engine, a heavy duty forged crank, forged pistons, four bolt main bearing caps, special alloy connecting rods, large port heads. Again, those large ports, they were the ones that dictated that porcupine configuration for the valves. Aluminum intake they had with a special Holley carburetor. If you could show the next picture, we're going to show the back of a Z16, and I had to just stick this picture in, but it's a good time to talk about the suspension of the car. Had a heavy duty suspension in it, had sway bars in it and stuff. And it was made to really move out there. It also had a heavy duty rear axle and a Muncie 4-speed transmission. There was a special frame on this car. It was based on a convertible boxed frame, and that's so there'd be less twisting when you took off from a standstill like in drag racing and put all that torque to the rear end. It wouldn't twist because of that, because of the sway bars I mentioned, also because of the special box frame there. It had special heavy duty power brakes. It had power steering components in this. Had a special interior. And the interior, you know, I read about this interior, and there's some things in it that we take for granted now, 46 years later, but it's talking about the Lux front and rear seat belts, you know, the Lux seat belts. That's something back then, I guess. It had 160 mile an hour speedometer, had a tachometer in the dash, had a Delco AM/FM multiplex stereo radio. And I'm gonna have a little quote here. This is by Tom McCahill, who was an automotive writer for Mechanics Illustrated, and he was well known for some of the phrases he would use when he tested cars. And he wrote about the stereo radio. He said, "There's nothing in this world, Charlie, like slipping down the turnpike, being belted in the back by 375 horsepower and in the ear by 4-speaker Bach power." And I just thought that was kind of a unique thing. Okay, you could show the next picture. And this is a very unique thing. You look at those wheel covers. They are not alloy wheels there, but they're just the covers on them. And they were made out of stamped steel, and they were unique to these Chevelles here. And then in 66 Chevelle, they also had these wheel covers. They had mixed reviews. Carcraft magazine said they were the homeliest phony mag wheel hubcaps imaginable, huh? Okay, but Motor Trend said these boys came up with one of the most handsome and authentic looking simulated custom wheels we've seen. You have to get on your hands and knees and pick them with your fingernail to tell they're not the real thing. Okay, and so that was those wheels. The tires on them, and you can't see it real well here, but they were the gold stripe Firestone tires that came with them, which are pretty unique, and you know, you don't see many of them at shows. And usually if you see them at shows now, they're on Corvettes of the same vintage. The colors of them, if you'll show the next picture, please. These cars only came in three colors. You saw a yellow one, and now you're seeing a red one here. And they also came in black. They had three colors of interiors, black, red, or white. And some of them had vinyl tops, some didn't. And the vinyl top came in either black or black. There's only one color for that. And if you could show the next picture, please. Thank you. And this, again, is a nice side view of a Z16. And I said right in the beginning that Chevy was doing this to kind of introduce the 396 to the public. They really pushed for the next year to really start cranking these things out. But also the whole Chevy image, they wanted to go up because, you know, they're fighting against the own GM in-house GTO, and there's other companies out there starting to make these muscle cars. So this is Chevy's foray into it. Most of these cars, out of the 200 they made in 65, about half of them were used for promotional purposes. I had copies I saw on the internet of from GM, and they talk, you know, we want these cars to be promoted in a certain amount of cities. They mentioned the cities. They mentioned a certain amount of magazines they wanted them mentioned in. It was everything was very well calculated to get the name out of it. So I said about half of them were used in promotional purposes. A lot of them were given to certain people. I have A.J. Foyt was one of the ones who got one. Phil Hill, who was another race driver from back then, got one. Brix Cunningham was another one. And Dan Blocker was another one. And Dan Blocker, in case you don't know about him, was from the old Bonanza TV show, and he got one of them, apparently the first one. Okay, and we have a caller on, please. Hello?
Hi.
Yes.
I ran a 66 Chevelle at Maple Grove when it was new, 396, 375 horse.
Yes.
And we were always trying to better our time, so we got the bright idea to take the air cleaner off before we ran it down the strip.
Okay.
And about halfway down the strip, we heard this horrible sound, the sucking sound, and the car just quit. Sucked the insulation right off the bottom of the hood into the carburetor.
How about that?
Now, why didn't we know better?
Yeah. You learn from it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, a learning experience.
Yeah. But it was very unusual. It was a 66, 396 SS, but it was Power Glide.
Oh, okay.
So you just kind of torqued it up at the line and took your foot off the brake, but it was...
Wow.
I mean, it was fast, though, but...
What kind of speeds do you remember?
Oh,
or didn't he get any speeds before it sucked the...
I don't remember the speeds as much as the elapsed time was around 12-something.
Okay. Wow. Yeah, well, I'm going to... Well, the thing is, I got some times on this here, quarter-mile time by Motor Trend was 15.3 seconds. So you did pretty good there.
Well, this was on street tires too. Mm-hmm. Although we did take mm-hmm. some air out of the tires first.
But, yeah.
You know, but that was back in the days when you could just about run anything up this strip.
Right.
Tommy Ivo with his 4-engine Buick dragster.
Mm-hmm.
That was a long time ago. But anyway, I just thought of that when you were talking about 396
okay.
Chevelle. So. Hey, I love the show, by the way. Everything is good.
Okay, thanks.
Keep up the good work.
All right, yep.
Okay, bye. Great.
Yeah, thanks for calling in.
Okay. I had a couple other things here, and I'm almost done here, but this is kind of interesting. I mentioned some of the people who got the car. I mentioned Dan Blocker was one of them. Again, Chevy was really pushing this, and I have a quote from Chevrolet. The cars were made available to newsmen as a result of the interest shown in the engine by sports and performance segment of the public. So they were getting it out. Motor Trend said it was the king of the road, that car. And Motor Trend also said the way horsepower figures are bandied about nowadays, we never know what to expect, but this one's got it. From idle to red line, it's definitely got it. There's no brief range where it feels like it comes on the cam. It puts out gobs of romp and stomp and torque throughout the range of useful RPM. And I just thought that was kind of interesting. And one last thing before I go back to you, David, is in 1965, Paul Revere and the Raiders made a song, SS-396. It was all about this car, and it's pretty neat. And, you know, I was going to have Kendra sing it, but I didn't tell her ahead of time.
Well, the question is, did one of the band members actually have one of the cars?
It could be. It was only in a 45,
yeah.
And there's not. It didn't make it to an album.
How's that go again, Dan?
Yeah, they probably
sing a bar for me.
Yeah, for 45, they probably didn't get the car.
That's it. Yeah.
Didn't get much for a single. Yeah. You know.
Okay. Anyway.
Okay.
Back to you.
Well, all right. Well, great. Well, thanks. Thanks, Dan. I appreciate that a lot. Okay. Well, now we're going to move on to Mike with his Tech Talk section, and tonight his topic is horsepower.
And me and Dan didn't talk before the show about horsepower, okay? This was unplanned. So he was just talking about the 375 horsepower 396. Before I go to horsepower, though, I want to show a picture and address a question that I had from a home viewer last month. Last month, I talked about gear ratios. And I talked about several different kind of gears meshing. And a customer or a home viewer called in and asked about a gearbox, and I explained it as ball bearings working through a gear, and the correct word is a recirculating ball bearing steering box. And if you could show the first picture, I found this and I wanted to bring it in. Hopefully the home viewer is watching tonight. And picture one will show the inside of a Saginaw steering box that they used from 1956 to 1978. So then once we get that, then I'm going to go on to the horsepower. But anyway, yeah, there's a nice picture of it. Basically, as you turn the steering wheel, the ball bearings recirculate around the what I would call the sector shaft, and the teeth on the bottom, they would turn, and that would be your range, say 6 or 7 inches, that you'd be able to turn the front suspension. So that is another type of gear that I touched on last month, but I didn't have a good picture of a ball bearing type box, like I said, and they used that for 30 years, and Chrysler, Ford, all of them had that type of box. And all boxes, home viewers should know, is they are adjustable to take the play out of them. And that was the idea with this one too. You could turn a screw down and it would tighten up the mesh and make you have tight steering after the car got some miles on it. So that's it for the question that was asked to me last month. And now we'll talk a little bit about horsepower. And horsepower, if you ask a car enthusiast what horsepower means, most people don't really, I mean, they know what it means, but they don't know the how it became about. They would think the logical thing, it's how many horses it takes to pull a load or so forth, and that's pretty much it. It was developed by a guy named James Watt back in the 1700s. He was also the inventor of the steam engine on trains. So he came up with this formula. It's actually just a formula, and he had a horse that did so many revolutions in a circle, and he came up with this formula that one horsepower equals 33,000 foot-pounds of torque in 1 minute. So horsepower is I guess, it's not a scientific thing. It's just a formula that someone developed 200 years ago that we still use today, and we follow that formula. I mean, it's not written concrete that it's 375. It's just a guide that this James Watt developed 200 years ago, and we still use it today. And we talk about horsepower as, how many horses it would have take to move this load that the train was hauling. And it's amazing that it stuck around all these years and it's still used today. And it's a measurement of a formula that this James Watt developed. And it helped sell, the proper size engine to pull the cars, the steam locomotive. That's how it started. So, and it's been around, like I said, for 200 years, and we'll go into the 60s, kind of like what Dan was talking about. They used the horsepower ratings more, prevalent. I mean, they used it all the years, but in the 60s, it was the horsepower wars. And what they would do is they would test the horsepower on an engine dynamometer, and they would inflate the horsepower sometimes for bragging rights. And in the like we'll say about 1968, the insurance companies were raising insurance, and people were car sales were down because they were high and expensive to insure. So then they went the other way, and they started underestimating the horsepower on an engine dyno. And how they would do it is sometimes they'd run the motor with open headers, sometimes they'd run it with no accessories on it. That would inflate the horsepower. And then if they wanted to adjust it down, like, for example, I'll just use Camaro, 302 was rated at 290 horse, or actually it was probably about 330. And so they would detune it. They would back the timing down, or maybe go a little bit in the jetting of the carburetor, and just different little things that would make it rated lower to qualify for a race or to lower insurance. So, and up until 1972, that's pretty much the way things went. Now, you'll hear all the car guys out there saying, for example, a Corvette took a tremendous loss of horsepower in 72 or 73. The reason being is, everybody will blame it on the smog and the gas crunch and so forth. But in that time frame, they started testing them on a chassis dyno, meaning in the car, delivered to the rear wheels. So that's one reason the horsepower dropped, besides smog and trying to get air gas mileage and lowering compression ratios. The way we've tested horsepower in the 70s up until this day is more realistic. It's done in the vehicle or on a chassis dyno, meaning that the rear wheels are driven in the car where the torque converter, the gears, the drive shaft, the rear end, all those gear ratios I talked about last month, they come into play to actually give you a number that's at the pavement, at the rear wheel. That's something that I didn't know, and it's a good little information there you can put away the next time somebody starts talking about the 170 horsepower Corvette in 1977. It might have actually been 275 on an engine dyno, on a stand, not in the vehicle's frame. So the next picture, if you could show it, is dyno's. Oh, that's the store. That one we'll skip. That's the steering box still. You could skip that one and go to the Super Chevy magazine. There was a good article in there this month about chassis dynos and horsepower. There's a typical graph of engine making horsepower. If you could show the next page over, that'll show you the power curve at so many RPMs. If you could show the page aside of that, there's different graphs that'll show you at the bottom there, engine speed, RPM, in thousands. So you can see the horsepower peak there at about, it looks to be about 5,500 RPMs, then it starts tailing off. And I believe there's a chart on the side that'll show the horsepowers at different RPMs that's up and down. If you could show that one, then that would explain the torque. At some point in torque and horsepower, they intertwine. At some point in any chart, you'll get to a point that the horsepower and the torque equal each other. I know it's a little hard to understand, but it's not the same RPM. So, for example, at 1,800 RPMs, you could have 400 pounds of torque, and at 4,800 RPMs, you'd have 400 horsepower. It's kind of a neat little fact that I found, and everybody wants to add more horsepower to their cars. In the old days, we did headers, different intake manifold, different carburetor. We had somebody tune it. For example, the timing that the specs in a book sometimes are way off. You can get more horsepower by advancing the timing. You can get more gas mileage by advancing the timing. You have to take into consideration the slop of the timing chain. And not every engine's the same. So how can they say that a Ford motor or a Chevy motor or a Chrysler motor is 8 before top dead center? That's where people like Jenkins and people from the 60s that have worked with this blueprinting, which I did on a show about blueprinting an engine. That's a factor of this, how they can tweak out an extra couple horsepower or extra torque. And so you at home, you can do a little research on your particular motor and find out, what it likes, road and track, some of the magazines, your Ford magazine, Chevy, whatever, will give you some pointers on getting horsepower out of your car, which usually means gas mileage. Because if you can get more horsepower, that means you don't have to press the pedal down as far and it will add gas mileage. One of my first Corvettes I had when I was younger, I got over 20 miles to the gallon with that car just by advancing the timing and tweaking, some of the specs on it. And again, last month we talked about gear ratios. That all enters into horsepower. What kind of gears are in the transmission? What kind of rear gears you have? So now with the new cars today, we have chips and we have fresh air intakes, we have exhaust systems. So all these little things, depending on your make and model, will make horsepower, and usually it means gas mileage. So that's what we have tonight on horsepower. I hope I've made a couple good points that you can use when you're out looking at cars, and thank you very much.
Well, thanks, Mike. I mean, we always learn a lot, and
yep.
Of course, once again, you've burst one of my bubbles and fantasies of seeing 275 horses hooked up to a little tiny wagon to determine the power of something. So thanks again.
You're welcome.
I guess if you didn't know, the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles is a great place to have parties for kids and adults. The museum can help you throw a great party for a birthday, wedding, or any personal or business event. You can enjoy first-rate food from our caterer in a very unique setting, which is the museum itself. If you're interested, please call our operations manager during business hours. That's 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. Monday through Friday, and she can give you all of the details. The museum is also a great place for your serious business meetings or an unusual venue for your club special meeting. So why not plan on having your next meeting in an environment that is both interesting and fun? The Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. Here is the email and the phone number. Phone number is 610-367-2090, and the email is mail@boyertownmuseum.org. We will now take a short break to hear from BCTV.
You're watching Wheels Along the Road on BCTV.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and other related stories, go to www.bctv.org. Program underwriting is a valuable source of revenue for bctv.org. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
Okay, yeah, welcome back to the show. If you've just tuned in, you're watching Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm your host, David Beard, and the show is here at this time each month. Our guest tonight, again, is Sam Fiorani, and he is here to talk to us about some famous automotive lemons and the people who love them. Sam?
Thanks.
Take it away.
This show usually spends about an hour talking about great historic cars and trucks, of which there are many. I've done research on many cars over the years, but the ones that intrigue me most are the ones that are least loved. We usually refer to them as clunkers or heaps or jalopies. I'm simply just going to call them lemons. If you can put the slide back up, please. I can't possibly go into all the lemons that have been built over the history of cars, so I'm going to concentrate on one man's efforts to sell Americans lemons. Malcolm Bricklin was born in Philadelphia in 1939. His family moved to Florida, and he graduated from high school there in 56. He dropped out of the University of Florida 2 years later and went to work for his father's building supply store. It was while he was working there that he had the inspiration that would direct the rest of his professional life. His father's handyman stores were expanded, and Malcolm had the idea to franchise the name. In 62, Handyman America promised to provide advertising, inventory control, and central warehouse to keep his store stocked with product. Franchises were sold, but the company failed to raise enough cash to build the required warehouse, so Bricklin began selling regional franchises. This overexpansion resulted in the company filing for bankruptcy in 65, even though Bricklin states he sold the company for $1 million. After leaving Handyman America and reportedly broke, he moved to Philadelphia, where he became a business consultant. While traveling through Italy, he was searching for a money-making opportunity, and Bricklin stumbled upon Lambretta scooters, built by Innocenti. The company had a large number of unsold scooters in New York, and Bricklin promised to sell them, which he did, and he made a few bucks doing such. This whet his appetite for motor vehicles, and he found a Japanese scooter called the Rabbit, which he started selling in 1967. The Rabbit was built by Fuji Heavy Industries, and after getting involved with the company, he started negotiating with the company to sell their cars. They had just introduced a new front-wheel drive subcompact called the 1000 Super Deluxe, and Bricklin really wanted to sell this car. But Fuji was not interested in spending the money to bring this up to U.S. specs, to bring it through federalization. So Bricklin looked through their catalog and found a loophole. The 1000 Super Deluxe weighed 1,500 pounds, but Fuji's smaller 360 weighed in at 965 pounds. At the time, federal laws said that a car under 1,000 pounds was technically a motorcycle. So you didn't have to put bumpers on it, and you didn't have to put seat belts on it, and you didn't have to put safety glass. So Bricklin talked to Fuji and got the rights to sell this car, which at the time was already 10 years old. Bricklin and his buddy Harvey Lamb formed Subaru of America in Pennsauken, New Jersey. The deal was with Fuji was to sell 2,000 of these in 68, rising up to 5,000 in 71. Underfinanced, Bricklin and Lamb went about selling dealership franchises again and company stock so they could raise the money. They got 80 dealers to sign up, including a few around here. With the necessary capital, Subaru of America built their corporate headquarters and started selling the $1,297 car. Enough were sold so they could borrow some more money and expand the company. In early 69, Subaru of America had a negative cash flow of about $750,000 and a car that wasn't selling very well. Yet they increased their quota and extended the contract into the 1980s. As this was happening, Consumer Reports reviewed the 360 and said with a 0 to 50 time, 23 seconds slower than the Volkswagen Beetle, and bumpers said to be virtually useless against anything more formidable than a watermelon, the car was clearly labeled as not acceptable. They had a three-page review of it, and in the review, Consumer Reports' only positive statement was, the brakes themselves exhibited sufficient capacity to handle the car's inertia. Oh, and they also said it was a pleasure to squirm out of the Subaru and slam the door and walk away. The trickle of sales that they had before that evaporated after the magazine appeared. With no demand for the product, Bricklin had two problems. What would Subaru of America sell, and how would they get rid of these cars? To get rid of the cars, Bricklin came up with another franchise idea. He took the leftover 360s and rebodied them. He sold fast track franchises and sold the idea to companies around the country where they would sell a buck a lap races to consumers. Franchise holders would get 10 cars, uniforms, helmets, lighting, and a fence, but the business had to supply their own track. Brochures said, once behind the wheel, you rev up the throaty engine while waving a salute to the crowd in the grandstands. The authentic Christmas tree starter lights begin blinking, and with wheels spinning behind the roaring engine, you're off on the most thrilling ride of your life. Probably an understatement. For what Bricklin and Lamb had, they went back to Japan to talk to Fuji about getting the larger model. According to the book, Where the Suckers Moon, Bricklin told Fuji that if they wanted to resurrect the Subaru name in America, they'd have to get the bigger car. Fuji agreed and gave him the FF1 Star, which is the upgraded version of the old 1000. Even with the superior product, Subaru continued to lose money and losing as much as $4 million by 71. They needed a new investor, and they found one in a rich family in Binghamton, New York. The Kaufman family agreed to buy 36% of the company as long as Bricklin left. Bricklin was given a 3-year consulting contract, relief of his debt he owed to Subaru, and he was given fast track. Subaru of America currently sells 200,000 vehicles in the United States a year. According to Bricklin's own bio, in the early 80s, he had a new vision, one marked by a concept that has become the cornerstone of the car industry, safety first. He decided to take his expertise in the automotive industry and create a car worthy of his name. Bricklin brought a series of stylists and engineers, in case some with actual Detroit experience, including Bruce Myers, Terry Tanner, Herb Grassi, Garth Dewey, and Tom Monroe. They created a two-seat sports car, designed with safety in mind. The prototype was cobbled together with parts from Datsuns and Plymouths, but the production car ended up being using more AMC parts, including the 360 V8. Bricklin found more investors, including the Canadian and New Brunswick governments, who ponied up considerably more money than they expected. The plant was opened in St. John's, New Brunswick, Canada, employing a bunch of local people to build the car. The cutting-edge Bricklin SV1 entered production in 74 with its trademark gull-wing doors and color-impregnated acrylic body panels. The car suffered from a number of quality problems, including leaking doors, weak lifting mechanism for the 100-pound doors, and cracking acrylic body. The factory shut down and went bankrupt in September of 75. New Brunswick was left with $23 million investment worth nothing. Fewer than 2,900 cars were built. The Bricklin SV1 named one of 50 worst cars of all time by Time Magazine in 2007, but it spawned a commemorative stamps and coins, a few books, a stage musical, a song, and no fewer than two documentaries.
Musical?
After a few years, Bricklin moved on and formed the International Automotive Importers. The company took over the importation of the Bertone X19 and the Pininfarina Azura after Fiat stopped selling them in 82. Selling only a handful of these old cars wasn't going to keep Bricklin in business, so he went looking for another product, and he found it in the Zastava Corral, an inexpensive little hatchback built in Yugoslavia based on an old Fiat platform. The car was introduced to the American public in August of 85 as the Yugo GV. Yugo of America was formed to support the sales of the car, and introduced about the same time as the Hyundai Excel, Yugo was $1,000 cheaper than its nearest competitor. 90 dealers were set up, and sales were really good. In the first 4 months, more Yugos had been sold than Bricklins had been built. In less than a year, Bricklin had sold more Yugos than he had sold of all other cars in the prior two decades. Sales went past Saab in 87. Bricklin's company was doing great. They were even negotiating with a company in Malaysia to sell cars in the U.S. But owners started complaining about the engines, the transmissions, the electrical systems, pretty much the whole car. Bricklin got out while getting was good. He sold out the company in 88, and the company went bankrupt in 89. Yugo tried to keep things going by adding fuel injection, an automatic transmission, and a convertible model, but the doors finally closed in 92. The Yugo GV was rated as one of the 50 worst cars of all time by Time Magazine in 2007. You see a pattern here? Bricklin, ever the entrepreneur, moved on. He founded the Electrical Bicycle Company in 95, which sold the EV Warrior bike. This is him sitting on the bike. The company folded in 97. In 2002, Bricklin announced he had formed a new company called New Car Co., which intended to import what else? Zastava Motors cars again, calling them this time the ZMW. Selling for half the price of the nearest competitor, Bricklin was sure he had another winner, even though Zastava's plant, which had been bombed by NATO, only built about 11,000 vehicles in the entire previous year. Nobody seemed to take ZMW seriously, even now. So Bricklin headed back east. ZMW became Visionary Vehicles, and they started negotiating with the Chinese to sell cars in the U.S. He came across Chery Motors. This is one of the Chery Motors cars, which was one of the few manufacturers not under government control in China. With the belief that this was the next Honda, Bricklin recruited a number of people inside the U.S. auto industry and even more investors. The plan was for 250 dealers in the U.S. selling the Chery vehicles, with dealers investing $2 to $4 million each. After the contracts were signed, according to Bricklin, Chery decided to team up with Daimler Chrysler instead, leaving Bricklin with nothing except for a number of lawsuits and dealers with nothing to sell. Visionary Vehicles moved on from Chery to their latest plan, which is to build another Bricklin. This Bricklin is the EVX LS, which he planned to enter in the Progressive Automotive X Prize a few years ago, that was to show a mass-producible 100-mile-per-gallon four-passenger car. Claims for the hybrid electric car were for a five-passenger car that could do 0 to 60 in under 6 seconds, have a range of 850 miles, and a price tag of about $35,000. His pitch was so convincing, he attracted all kinds of investors, including a Canadian battery company. Production is planned for the near future. Bricklin's son put together a documentary on his father called The Entrepreneur. And I looked it up, and the dictionary calls The Entrepreneur any person who manages an enterprise usually at considerable risk. With the kind of products that Bricklin has been selling over his career, it seems that the buying public has been taking the biggest risk of all.
Well, that was pretty entertaining, Sam. Do you suppose that Bricklin's interest in these things was his early life in Florida, his interest in the citrus fruit?
It could be, yeah. But I really think he came up with the idea of franchising, and so he didn't really need a product. He just needed to sell the business to somebody else to get the money.
Yeah, I think the problem with the Yugo was he shouldn't have had Slobodan Milosevic on his board. probably should have had a better idea. Thanks a lot, Sam. Appreciate that. Okay, now it's time for Curator's Corner with Kendra Cook.
All right. Well, I'm going to talk about a slightly longer-lasting car, a little different. I'm going to talk about the museum's 1948 Chrysler Town and Country. And those of you who know about the museum know we do a lot with our locally built vehicles, and you might think that Chrysler doesn't fit into that category, and you'd be right. It's not locally built, but it still has a local connection. And the first photo I have is a drawing of three different designs that Paul Hafer submitted on behalf of the Boyertown Auto Body Works. And viewers at home probably will recognize the name Paul Hafer. He's the founder of the museum. He was at one time the president of the Body Works. He also did a lot of design work for the trucks. This was some of the work that he did. And Dodge had actually asked the Body Works to submit three wood-constructed station wagon bodies to be mounted on a 39 Dodge chassis. And this is what Paul Hafer submitted. In the upper left corner is the Town and Country, he called it. And you probably can't see on here because this is a copy of a copy, but the front area of that top car has an open cab over the driver. So the driver had no roof above him. Passengers were in an enclosed area. And he called it the Town and Country, he said, because it had that town car front and a country wagon rear. That's where he got that name. The car on the right, in the middle there, that is what he called the Country Club Sport, and that also has a different kind of roof. The back portion of it folded down. You might be able to see that at home. The third car is the Country Gentleman, and that's a fully enclosed body. After Paul submitted these to Dodge, it was actually decided that Chrysler would market these cars instead, and that kind of makes sense if you think about today. Even still, we kind of associate Chrysler as being slightly more luxurious, a little more expensive than the Dodge line, and these are kind of show-stopping cars, they're supposed to be. Also, with that decision, though, Chrysler decided that they were not going to contract the bodywork out of house, so to speak. So they would be building their own bodies. And even though they liked Paul's design, they didn't use these designs, but they did use that name, Town and Country, that first drawing at the top. They used that name for their estate wagons, which they introduced in 1941. And 1941, of course, was the same year that the United States entered World War II. So only 200 of those Town and Countries were produced in 1941. So it looked as though maybe this car had a short lifespan. But after the war and civilian car production started up again, people were starved for new designs. This had been an attention-getting design when it was introduced, so Chrysler went back to it, and they introduced five different Town and Country models in 1946. And again, our vehicle at the museum is a 1948. It has a six-cylinder L-head engine, with fluid drive transmission. Some of the models had 8-cylinder engines. This one's a 6-cylinder. That lovely green color is the factory name of that was Heather Green, and the wood was painted, was stained in Catalina tan and Rossini brown. And you can see there's a lot of woodwork on this car. That is a shot of the door, and you can see how thick those doors are. It's a heavy piece, lots of wood. There's an interior shot, some kind of fancy upholstery work going on in there. And I just included this shot because it's just a sign of the times. If you see in the middle of that seat, you're looking at the back of the front bench seat. There looks like a little green box there. That's a cigarette lighter mounted for the convenience of your back seat passengers. So you don't see that anymore. But anyway, this line was popular for several years until they started to realize that all that woodwork needed to be revarnished about twice a year, and people don't particularly like that kind of work going into their cars usually. So production dropped to just under 700 units in 1950. After 1950, the woodwork disappeared, and they became all metal-bodied station wagons, the Town and Country line. And in the 80s, Chrysler would go back to that 40s styling in a way. They added some models would have that plastic trim that resembled the wood grain, sort of a callback to the original styling. And, you know, Town and Country, of course, is still used by Chrysler today, that name. That's their name for their minivans. So, of course, that's a very different car than what it started out as in the 40s. But we still use it, and those minivans have a shared history with the Museumstown in Chrysler, and that history began in Boyertown. So, still around today.
Well, thank you, Kendra. That's great. That's really a very pretty car, and we would like to get it out more, and would, of course, like to have people come see it at the museum. And at the museum, we're always looking for volunteers. We could use volunteers. Who can give us tours, who can help us take care of the cars, who can do research, work in the library. There's a whole range of things. So if you're interested in an opportunity to volunteer at the museum, just give us a call or email us. The phone number at the museum is 610-367-2090, or you can email us at mail@boyertownmuseum.org. So now I guess we're to the part of the show that people really like a lot, and hopefully we'll have a little more time than we had last month, our car quiz. And I guess what we'll do is we have our first car here. If we can shine it up, just see if anyone at home would like to take a shot at identifying. We'd like to know the make, model, and year if you can come up with it. Very snappy looking vehicle there, like that color. Even actually the perspective actually even gives the sense that it's moving towards you, I think.
There was one of these for sale, Hershey, that I was really looking at, and it had on the rear trunk a very rare option called a Coronado, which looks kind of like a Continental kit, a spare tire, but it's molded, not added to the rear trunk lid, it's molded right into it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and it was on the same year, same model as that car, which I'm not going to say what it is yet.
Okay, we seem to have a home viewer who wants to take a stab at it. Home viewer, what do you think?
Okay, I think I was thinking Ford, but now I'm thinking maybe probably a Plymouth, I believe, 1954.
Oh boy, you have the year right. And actually, your first guess was
a
correct.
Ford. Okay.
Yeah,
so it would have been a 54 Crown Victoria.
No, it's a Skyliner.
Skyliner, okay. Thank you. Well, good show again tonight. I enjoyed Sam's little presentation. That was very interesting.
Yeah, everybody loves lemons.
Sam, on the bigger thing.
Okay, thanks. Well, thanks, caller. Appreciate it. Okay.
Thank you.
Second car here. Hopefully, it's that's nice. Convertible. Maybe you don't normally see it in that that configuration. Not the car in the background. We want the one in the foreground. That's what we want there. The two-tone model. It's like a pair of gangster shoes.
I don't remember seeing too many convertibles like that.
I think that's why I picked it out. I mean, when I was doing the research and looking at all the pictures, I thought, okay, I'll pick one that's different from the normal crowd there that popped up and make it a little more challenging for people.
You should get bonus points for the car in the background.
There is a bonus. You win a little more nothing on top of the nothing you get for getting the answers right originally, if you get the bonus background car. And I don't know if any of our panel here have ever had one of these when they were...
I'm going to make a comment, not really on this car, but the previous car to tie in to this. If you looked, and it had the clear panel on the roof of the previous car.
Yes,
it wasn't
it
a convertible, but it was kind of this convertible hardtop idea, and everybody thought that was pretty cool. I think this is a better idea here.
Okay. We haven't had any bias on this, so I'll just go ahead and tell you it's a 1965 AMC Rambler Ambassador 990. All right, we'll go to the next car here, which is a... Sam cut one of my cars out. Rascal him. He threw me off. Okay. Decided we'd go with a different color. I just want to be a little, I didn't want to have the cars of the same color, not only the same make, manufacturer. Anybody at home have an idea about this?
It's quite different than the competition that year.
It's
a bit older looking than the other.
Sure. No surprise.
We're stumping them tonight.
I should go back to the movie cars. I think people got those a lot. Okay, we'll go to this. The 1957 Dodge Coronet. We'll throw in another easier one maybe here. Here's one maybe somebody can... Ooh, Sam, what are you doing to me? What are you doing to me here?
What year is that?
It's 1933. I just threw that in because it was kind of a ringer. It's a Texaco Doodlebug fuel truck. Looks, it was the precursor to the Wienermobile. We appreciate you tuning in tonight, and thanks for watching the show. We always appreciate it. So just if you could join us next month, we'll all be back here again with lots of new car talk and tech talk. What do you know? Guest speaker and curator's corner. So for the Borgertown Museum of Historic Vehicles, I'm David Beard, and good night.